2-year anniversary of Geeks of Azeroth, and we're going to be talking about a whole bunch of stuff and giving away Legion at the end of the episode, so stay tuned for how you can win. By geeks.
About geeks.
For geeks.
Welcome to Geeks of Azeroth!
I think that was the most underwhelming cheer of excitement ever.
I thought it was, you know, something to get the crowds going.
Did we lose your webcam going there?
Oh, you have, actually.
Oh no.
Typical 2-year show.
Welcome back.
Thank you. I'll try and stick around.
So yeah, it's 2 years of Geeks of Azeroth. That's crazy. Big Voodoo, you've been here for what, 6 months? Probably 7 months? 11 months? 8, 10 months?
I don't know. I've been here for
a
while.
You've been here for a period of time.
Yeah, 2 years of Geeks of Azeroth.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
Maybe I just absorbed Zool, so I've been here since the start, too. You've never seen us in the same chat together.
Oh.
That is true. That is true.
Maybe that is what happened. Well, I guess we can do a quick recap on our weeks of gaming before we discuss 2 years. So, Britzza, we'll start with you. How's it been?
Oh, I'll keep it very short then. It's been another week of bashing my head against the Legendary Quest. I've given up trying to just tick it over with the Garrison missions on top of the Apexis quest and things like that, and just gone full out Apexis quests. But it's taking a lot longer. For some reason, like, my naval missions aren't coming up with the sort of quest that I want. Yeah, it's just going a bit slow, and I think it's now down to a routine. You know when, like, you log into the game and you kind of, like, you're not really thinking, you're just kind of tapping the buttons in a pre-agreed order, moving to a particular place. It just kind of plays itself. That's where I'm at. So I really need to find something to do to freshen up things. I might try a little bit of PvP in time. I think this week's Q&A has got me in the mood for a bit of PvP. And otherwise, really, I've been spending a little bit of time outside of Blizzard. So I was playing Destiny with Dracas earlier in the week. That game's still around. It's actually quite fun. I've never played it before. So I picked it up. And it's good. It's good. But, you know, obviously it's not quite the MMO that we're used to, shall we say. It's not quite like that. But, yeah, otherwise pretty quiet.
Big Voodoo.
A lot of losing. Like, I've been playing a lot of competitive games, and they have not been going terribly well for me. With the exclusion of my couple games of Overwatch this morning, which were pretty fantastic, like 40-plus kills in competitive with Anzo each game, I can live with that. Yeah.
And myself, I played my qualifiers of competitive mode and then immediately have quit playing Overwatch altogether. I'm kind of disgusted by the game entirely right now. But other than that, I haven't played, and we'll talk about some of the reasons why in the news of the week when we discuss the competitive mode. But otherwise, I haven't had a whole lot of time for gaming this week. For a lot of the week, I just wasn't online until like last night when I remembered it was the... Or maybe it was 2 nights ago. I remembered it was the BG weekend and WoW. And in the matter of just 2 evenings and this morning, fully geared my shaman.
Awesome.
From nothing. So that was fun. It does a lot of damage. So much damage. It's crazy.
It's surprising how quickly you can gear up in PvP now.
Mm-hmm. But with that BG weekend, 2 wins and you got a piece of gear. If you didn't get one from the first win strongbox. So, it's crazy.
That could be worth it. Maybe I should do that.
I mean,
should have done
anything,
that.
If anything, just get the tunes you want to level first in Legion. Just get them honor geared because it's I level 700, and that's better than normal mode and pretty much heroic mode raiding gear. So,
and it gets you into it cuts over a lot of raid content. Anyway, so you can kind of spearhead. I think it could get you at least into the end of Blackrock Foundry, if not.
Well, normal mode rating in Hellfire Citadel gives you 685 gear. So that into comparison of high-level 700 gear from PvP. Yeah. You outgear normal mode. So
PvP to win.
Yep. All right, so before we jump into news of the week, we're going to talk about ourselves, because we love to do that.
We love doing that, yeah.
like we said in the opening, it's been 2 years. Actually, 2 years and 1 week. We decided to skip last week and do it this week for timing purposes. But yeah, it's been 2 years and 1 week since we started Geeks of Azeroth. 2 years and 1 week ago, yeah. I didn't even know you, Big Voodoo.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's crazy to think, yeah, like how long ago that was, but at the same time, in terms of the show, like it doesn't feel like that long ago.
No, it really doesn't.
We're 80 episodes in, and yeah, we haven't done an episode every week. If we, you know, it's still 104 weeks of, you know, having this show in the background potentially. It's crazy, absolutely crazy.
Mm-hmm. It's nuts. Yeah, I had words in my mind and where they went.
I guess, like, to kick it off, so here we are, 2 years. I think, like, the cliche thing to say would be, like, I didn't see it coming this far. But to be honest, I didn't never see an end to Geeks of Azeroth. It was always something that kept going, but I never knew what it was going to look like. And we never know, I think, what it's going to look like day to day. I don't think any of us really have like a long-term plan for this. I mean, we just kind of beat up.
Yeah, I mean, like each week I'm like, oh, this is still going, all right, here we go.
It's when I'm messaging you like, by the way, come do the show.
No, I mean, I'll say the cliche thing, I didn't think we'd make it 2 years down the road. I mean, and obviously we wouldn't keep doing it if you guys wouldn't keep listening, so stop it already, we're sick of doing this. Just kidding, this is awesome, thank you guys for listening. Obviously we wouldn't be doing it if we didn't have listeners, so we appreciate it. And I know Zul wishes he could be here.
He does.
Maybe he is.
Okay, all right. Are we just going to keep that going? Should we just start calling you Big Zuldu?
Sure. Honorary. That's right. I guess to kind of move it away from us for a moment.
How dare you? This is our show.
It's all about us. But like at the same time, like when we started this show, I think it's gonna sound a bit cliche, but I wanted a chance to sort of sit down and talk to people about games I really love that basically my other friends in the real world, as it were, don't really play. And in that 2 years, like a lot has changed. Like we've kind of come into this podcasting community and kind of made a kind of name for ourselves, or, you know, at least been recognized more widely than I thought we would. And the whole podcasting scene has changed massively. We kind of find ourselves like in this new world and things like that. And I just wonder what you guys thought about like Blizzard podcasting in general and how far it's come in the last 2 years.
I think we hopped in at kind of an opportune time, because there were some podcasts that were around right when we were starting. It's kind of what inspired me. Legendary Podcast, for example, that was on Gamebreaker TV. And around the time we were starting, they were kind of like all splitting apart. Lore went to work at Blizzard. And so like their whole group was splitting apart. So like there was this surge of new communities starting up, including ours. So I think we hopped in at this whole wave of new podcasts, and now we're just a part of this community. Now it's not as like these big communities that followed like one or two podcasts. Now it seems like it's spread out and it's a whole community of podcasting communities. It's interesting to be a part of, if that makes sense. Communities within communities.
Yeah.
I said community so many times in that sentence, but subgroups of podcasts now, when there used to be just like one or two big ones that everyone listened to, you know. That's definitely changed.
How do you feel about it, Big Foodie? About everything? 2 years, or, you know, even though you've been here just for a short period of it in comparison.
You know, I haven't seen a whole lot of changes, honestly, and a little bit. We're maybe less prepared now than when I first started, or maybe it's that I'm just more used to winging it now.
Oh, you should have been there from day one, man.
Yeah, day one was the there's flying by the seat of your pants, and then there's flying without pants, and that's how very much how we were going. notes? What are notes?
I don't know, like, I've noticed small differences. I'm much more comfortable on the show, but, you know, I definitely hopped in as the new guy. Yeah. Just didn't know, well, I knew Tarley, obviously, that's how I got on the first time, but seemed to go pretty well, so I don't know, it's...
You just, I guess you knew what you were talking about when you stuck around.
Yeah.
It helps when people know what they're talking about, because I feel safe.
That or I'm at least really good to BS about it.
Yes. Yeah. It could be that way.
And while we're talking about episode one, put on your rose-tinted glasses for a minute and prepare
I'm
for
so
a nice
sorry about this.
3.5-minute clip. Just an audio clip. You can stare at our faces, listen to it awkwardly for 3.5 minutes. But this is some... a compilation of stuff from episode one of Geeks of Azeroth. So, take a listen.
Welcome to Geeks of Azeroth, everyone. My name is Patrick, a.k.a. Tarley. And with me, I have Jake and Thomas. Why don't you guys introduce yourselves?
Cool thing, yeah. I'm Jake, a.k.a. Zool.
I miss him so much.
I will be part of Geeks of Azeroth as well.
You notice he sounds a little bit like me, too?
People, unfortunately, already know me. That's a bad thing. You probably know me from the Epic Geeks podcast. I'm Tom.
But moving on, let's go right away to the big news this week. Warlords is officially out of alpha and has moved into beta testing as of yesterday.
Woo!
Yes.
Hopefully this means some progress. I would hope so. Maybe we could see a release sooner than what we were thinking, but now that we are officially into beta, they have also unveiled their new zone, Tanan Jungle. This is being the introduction quest line for how you will get through the Dark Portal. You come into Tanan Jungle, and you fight off this wave of Iron Horde while you try and shut off the Dark Portal, ultimately leaving you stuck in Draenor as well. Thoughts on this, guys?
From the few screenshots I've seen, it looks pretty cool. Like, I want to get in there. I want to play around in there.
The big backlash, Lore immediately hopped on the forums to say a few things. He said that, well, the cities are still accessible. You can still go there, but the portals and everything are going to be on Ashran. That doesn't matter to me. I wanted as a player, I wanted my faction home to be in that really big spire of a city in Frostfire Ridge. It was cool. I wanted everyone to be hanging out there, not in a little camp. Just outside of a massive battlefield.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You're level 100. Well, you will be level 100. We don't hang around in villages anymore. That was when we were back in Goldshire. When you're like, you're level 10.
Yeah.
Now it's cities.
Are we going to make Goldshire a capital too? I mean...
The rebellion.
Capital right now.
I mean, how often now are we going to see Alliance players rushing through and trying to storm the city now? Or Horde players rushing through? Because it is in this PvP zone. You're going to have all these people, especially if it's more of a one-sided server, you're going to have the Horde like, rawr, rawr. I know they have their technology to even it out while on Ashran. I just don't know how it's going to work for the capital. All right, so anything else before we close down the show, guys?
I don't think so.
Free legendaries for everyone at BlizzCon.
I hope we get something better this year at BlizzCon, but I mean... Got these little guys here, but I want something big. I want a mount that no one else can get in game.
Yeah, that's the Alliance chopper. Maybe they'll do that. Right. The Alliance chopper for BlizzCon.
I've heard a rumor that they're actually going to auction off, or like have a randomly chosen BlizzCon attendee to get the physical bike, the actual bike.
Yeah, I heard that.
It'd be really cool.
That's apparently one of them they're going to... There was a rumor that apparently one of them is going to be given away at BlizzCon to an attendee as part of something, and the other one is going to be auctioned off at the dinner, the charity dinner.
So,
if you want to make the most money, they need to auction the Horde one off.
Probably. Because no one wants the Alliance one anymore. It's
like, no. Like,
I don't care. I'd ride that Alliance bike all the way back to Montana from California. That'd be awesome.
You'd blind everybody. You'd be causing accidents the whole way.
Yeah, you probably need a license for a tank as well.
Yeah, I don't even know if those treads work well on concrete. Like, is that a highway?
Going like 10 miles an
hour. I just have to go off-road. Just to be safer off-road, just through the desert, you know?
Oh, I don't want to be the guy who has to pull you over.
Okay, so that's kind of a cringe-worthy view into our past episode. And, you know, that was the first time I'd listened through that whole clip. And, well, I'm still disappointed in Ashrae. I mean, come on.
Nothing's changed.
And I still wanted a unique mount from BlizzCon. Come on. Oh, well.
Doesn't that say something, though? Like, I in some ways, the thing that shocks me most is that our first episode of this show was looking into Warlords. Mm. We kind of only just got round to the circle again of looking into Legion.
Yeah.
If that doesn't
we
say
have
that...
gone through a full expansion cycle on this show. That's how old the show is. Our show is
But we've
expansion.
Only gone through an expansion cycle. 80 episodes of this.
Crazy.
Jeez.
All right, well, that's enough nostalgia for one day. Is it time to jump in news of the week, gentlemen?
Please.
All right.
Hey, we recording? Yeah? Okay.
News of the week.
That's right. Even though it is an episode all about us, there is still stuff to talk about that is newsworthy. We're going to kick it right off with Heroes of the Storm. They're announcing two new heroes coming to the game. We've got Gul'dan and Diablo 3's Aurel. Aurel? Mm-hmm. Uriel.
Aurel.
Aurel.
We'll go with Aurel.
Aurel. Gul'dan obviously being a mage type character, and Aurel being a support. They look pretty fun.
It's Aurel's abilities. They looked very sort of
not supporting.
Yeah, exactly. They don't look supporty at all. It looks very sort of forward DPS in some ways.
She's support the same way Symmetra is support.
Yes, that's it. So, yeah.
Well, I mean, she's they only showed two abilities. True. So she still has a third and an alt.
Which a lot of people are speculating is her res.
Yeah, and potentially even a passive, too. So, I mean, she could definitely still fit into the support more, but from what we've seen, yes. I mean, she
yeah,
does seem...
Passive support, for sure, which, I don't know, I think is a cool, you know, need for support, I guess. I mean, Rhaegar is a good example of an aggressive support as well. I mean, he's got more abilities that are healing, but yeah. Supports that do damage are fun to play.
No, Rhaegar's in the same boat, man. He's got one heal and one ult, so...
Yeah.
I think that Gul'dan... that fear ability, though, looks pretty
Gul'dan
disgusting.
Fear is pretty cool.
Gul'dan looks like he's gonna be broken.
Yeah.
Everyone's broken when they first come into the game, to be honest, but...
Yeah, but sometimes in a good way and sometimes in a bad way. Gul'dan is definitely going to be way too good.
Yeah.
We're saying that, the interrupts should be pretty limited to like a second, shouldn't they? If considering Blizzard's revamp and sort of tweaking things. So it shouldn't be too disruptive.
Right,
not as bad as previous releases, what I'm trying to say.
Yeah. They also showed off a volleyball Leeming, which looks adorable. And Lost Hidden Kingdoms? Is that right? Hidden Kingdoms?
Mystic
Arthas?
Kingdoms?
Mystic Kingdoms. Mystic Kingdoms. Something, some kind of Kingdoms Arthas, which is interesting. They changed all of it to be like Chinese and serpent dragons. And...
Have you ever played Dynasty Warriors?
Yes.
And he looks it's like Guan Yu from Dynasty Warriors.
Looks just like Guan Yu.
Where are they getting that from, that Mystic Kingdoms theme? I think I've missed...
They designed it in China, I guess, like a fan in China or something designed it and...
Okay, that's cool.
Yeah, that's where it came from.
So, Mystic Kingdoms Warcraft 2 movie, maybe? Because we know the one's going to be designing it.
Yeah, pretty much. All right, next bit of news, unless you guys had any more you want to talk about, Heroes of the Storm. Oh, the mounts.
Everything...
The mounts look cool, too.
Yeah, everything honestly looks really cool.
Mm-hmm. Indeed. Let's see, Diablo 3, now the game director. has left Blizzard. First, we lost their art director. Now, the entire game director for Diablo 3 has left the building. But there's a spot up on Blizzard's career page. I don't know if that's the first time that's ever happened on the show, but if I've made
it, I think it is.
There we go.
That's it. 2 years and all the decorum goes.
I'm just letting myself go at this point.
Yeah.
There's a spot on the Blizzard career page for a lead developer for Diablo to lead the franchise into the future, is what it says. Does that mean new expansion? Diablo 4? New Diablo type game entirely? Who knows? I mean, this could be big.
That would be interesting. A new dungeon crawler from Blizzard.
Yeah. I would like to see Diablo in a different light, honestly. I mean, like, just from Diablo 1, 2, and 3, and then Diablo 4, it would just all be... I mean, people like the game, but it's just so similar. Such the same type of gameplay over and over again. You're staring at me, Big Voodoo. Like, you just... More numbers! Bigger numbers! More loot! Give it to me! I don't know.
No, actually, you said that, and I immediately thought about, oh, man, Blizzard needs to come out with another RTS. And...
Diablo RTS?
Demons, angels, and, like, humans? Pretty sweet.
Blizzard. Hello. We have just given you gold. what do you think, Britzza?
I'm for that. Admittedly, I was going through the tweet. Josh Masquire's announcement when he said he was leaving the community. And it's really nice to see sort of everyone sort of getting behind him. But at the same time, there's a lot of people, I think, quite nervous about the future of Diablo, because what does that mean? Was there ever an expansion on the go? Or is it a Diablo 4? I really don't know. I don't think Blizzard knows clearly anymore what's going on. So
I know, oh, well. I was really thinking, like, this would be the year we hear something about Diablo at BlizzCon, but
I think
the game
not.
Director leaving and all that, I'm thinking probably not. It'll still be
unless fun. They've done it and it's kind of almost there, and they just need someone to finish it off.
That's true. Maybe, yeah. Maybe they're already. It's a work in progress, and the game director doesn't agree with it, which can happen from time to time. You know.
Because how long's Reaper of Souls been out?
Since 2012. No, 2014. Yeah.
2014. So they must have been working on something for 2 years.
Yeah, you would think. Just doing the seasons is not enough for the entire Diablo team. I would think, unless they cut the Diablo team to a very small Hearthstone team size.
Yeah. Which piled them into Legion.
I would believe that.
You're making skins. You're on skin duty, grunt.
I don't know. Diablo's future is really up in the air at this point. Because there's no leaks of titles. There's no... The game director's left. We just have no idea what's going on.
And I keep wanting... At the back of my mind, I keep hoping that they're going to, like, take what they've learned from the Warcraft movie and think about, like, a Diablo movie.
Well, if they learn from the Warcraft movie, they would learn that video game movies in America don't do very well. So they might not do that.
Full Chinese cast. With Jackie Chan as Diablo. That will make loads of money.
On an off point, just random tangent here, speaking of video game movies, I really wonder how the Assassin's Creed movie now coming out this fall is going to do in comparison to Warcraft. I think it'll do better just because it's Assassin's Creed.
I think it'll do better in America, but maybe not in other countries. Like, I think Warcraft may do better in other countries than the Assassin's Creed movie has
done.
Warcraft
has gone over 400 million now.
Mostly from China.
And Japan, since it opened in
China really
recently. Yeah.
I think the thing with computer game films, or video game films in general, is that they always struggle to get the balance of telling people about their lore, like establishing the world, and having a plot that's worth watching. They get one of those wrong. And I think the Warcraft movie kind of got the world building a little bit weak and kind of felt like it had to juggle its story so much to accommodate that. But I think with Assassin's Creed, like, even if you had no idea about Assassin's Creed, you could probably work it out. It's historical.
Unless the whole Abstergo thing, it just gets really twisty and convoluted, and kind of the same way Warcraft is you kind of have to know what's going on when you go into the movie.
But I think a lot more people will be familiar with films like Minority Report and Total Recall. Yeah. That they'll kind of get that it's sci-fi at the very least, I think. I hope so. To be honest, it was the worst part of that game. So why they kept it, I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so a little bit of a tangent on Diablo. Anything else before we move on?
Nope.
Okay. So this past week, Overwatch competitive play has launched, and it has been pretty controversially received throughout the entire Overwatch community. You know, some people love it, some people hate it, some people don't play it. Personally, like I said in the opening, I played my qualifiers and was done with the game. And I'm not going to go into the personal reasons, but I'm going to go into why the main flaws in the Overwatch competitive mode, why people dislike it so much. And it's the give and take of your rated points. It's so unbalanced, it makes it for a very unpleasant experience. Basically, you win one game and it's an awesome game. You maybe get a quarter of a way to your next rank. Then the next game, you lose an entire rank. And oh, maybe you lose then five games in a row. You've lost 5 points, but you win your next game. Oh, you're a quarter of the way up to the next rank.
I thought it was supposed to be the other way around.
Yeah, and they said it was supposed to be like this balance system. Well, if you're way better than the other team with your MMR, then you're going to get less points. Or if you're way worse and you win, then you're going to get more points for winning. But that's not how it's worked out. It's just been this massive loss, little gain through pretty much every matchup. And people are not happy with it. My personal reason would be the community of Overwatch is why I've stopped playing the game, but that is a personal preference. It's pretty much League of Legends and Call of Duty players in there right now. So.
Just wait for the next Call of Duty to come out, and then you can, show your face again. That sucks. Yeah. Admittedly, I haven't played Overwatch for probably the last couple of weeks. Yeah. I think it's one of those games where I'm just going to end up picking it up and for a couple of days and then dropping it. But I think, you know, any game where you'll feel like you're getting penalized, where you're playing a game and you think that sort of mentality where you think, if I lose this, it's going to be another 3 wins before I catch up, or in my case, with Heroes of the Storm, particularly with rank play, where I feel I put in 3 hours of game time and I'm in a worse position than when I started, that's when I end up dropping Heroes. For me, that's always the worst thing about Heroes, is where I feel like I've played and I've got less than what I started with. So I can see that probably really pushing a lot of people away from the game.
Even in the initial like 10 qualifiers, the rating it gives you afterwards made no sense, because how many of your qualifiers did you win, Big Voodoo?
Like 7 or 8.
And what was your rating then?
43.
I only won 2 out of my 10 qualifiers, and I was 46. So, it just goes to show you, it absolutely makes no sense on what the rating system was even based off of.
It doesn't make sense. It doesn't. The numbers don't even add up. You can't twist those numbers in any way to figure that out.
Like, the only argument you could make is you were playing against higher MMR players the entire time, but if I'm winning like 6, 7, 8 games in a row, why am I not getting put against those higher MMR players to balance out my wins and losses? Like, it just does not make sense to me.
And I do have to get this out there. I absolutely adore Overwatch. Like, it is such a well-made game. I love the characters. I love the universe. I love everything about the game, except for the other people playing the game.
To be fair, it's not everyone else playing the game. It's just there is a pretty heavy toxic
community. I come from a person, I'm a very competitive gamer. Like, I get, when I'm playing a competitive game, I play to win. And when I get people who aren't taking it that as seriously as I am, I just find it very frustrating. And I just have to take myself out of the equation. Even maybe I'll come back to the game, but that's where I'm sitting on Overwatch right now.
I'm trying to think of one of our many ideas that we send out to Blizzard to try and fix something.
Right, I mean, I don't know what the fix would be. Take away the coin flip, Blizzard. That's ridiculous. For sudden death. Come on, coin flip? Seriously?
It'd be interesting if they do that for the esports. Yeah. Just bring them forward. I think we're all in agreement that it's not a very good system, clearly. You just have to hope that they're acknowledging it, and they will change it if it doesn't work. I think it's just a question of how soon they realize it's not working. Yeah. And
development cycle, Blizzard has been very receptive to the community. So
the problem is, like, they nailed competitive play in terms of, like, how they've structured the maps and how they've structured the gameplay itself. It's just that rating system. Mm-hmm. The doesn't seem to make sense, whether that be awarding more points for wins than they currently do, or finding some way that actually seems like it accurately balances MMR.
The idea I've seen bounced around is getting rid of the 1 to 100 and just have it be a solid, like, MMR number, like StarCraft, for example, something like that.
I would be good with that. Like, I started playing StarCraft again just because of the ladder changes that they announced. It hasn't yet, but I wanted to be practiced up, man.
I totally want to go back to StarCraft when that comes out. I mean, that's a competitive game that has no teammates.
And I think that's the thing. So, you know, StarCraft isn't really a casual game.
No.
Well, I guess it can be, but it's not. That's why I've never got into it. I think Overwatch is still kind of maybe still stuck in that casual mode.
Yeah,
it's half and half is what I'd say. Like, there's definitely casual people who play Overwatch.
The casual people shouldn't play competitive mode.
Yeah. Ideally, that's how it would work out, but
you can't cut people out. You got to give everyone a shot.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I think because, unlike StarCraft, and it all comes down to my view that because this is also a console game, mm-hmm. this is kind of in uncharted water with Blizzard. I think console players will drop it a lot sooner, and I think that will shape how it's perceived.
I don't know. I think from what I hear, the console community is significantly better. I mean, maybe it's just because people can't troll each other and type a whole bunch of stuff to each other in chat like they do in PC. I mean, people can still troll each other over voice chat, but that just doesn't seem to happen as much, I guess. I don't know.
You know what the difference is? Hmm. It probably happens pretty close to as much. The difference is that console players are used to it. Yeah, I mean, if you're a console player who buys Overwatch, you've played Call of Duty on console, and you've played Halo, and when people troll you, you don't think anything of it. You're like, that guy's a jerk, but, you know, he's not as bad as that guy I used to play Call of Duty with all the time.
I guess if I were to, what I think could fix a lot of the problem with the Overwatch competitive mode would, I don't know, maybe more of a tutorial system in the game, or somehow a better way to incentivize people to play the roles that are required to make a good team composition. I mean, I know that hero, being able to switch heroes is a main core of the game. They're not going to limit the heroes that you can have on a team or anything like that. But something to discourage two Hanzos and a Widowmaker on an offensive team, you know.
That's a bad idea.
Yeah.
What's the thing in... I'm trying to remember the quest you have to do in WoW if you want to enter heroics?
Oh, dungeons. The Proving Grounds.
Proving Grounds. What if there was a Proving Ground system?
Yeah.
That work?
Well,
would you do that by role?
It requires you to get to 25 to get in. What if you had to, like, win or play a certain amount of matches as each role? I don't know.
Yeah. Or at least do a tutorial as the... I don't know, like, because at the end of the day, how hard would a tutorial be?
Yeah.
The problem with Overwatch is because, like, countering your opponent's picks is so crucial. Mm-hmm. Two Hanzos and a Widowmaker makes zero sense on an offensive team, unless there's a bunch of Bastions and Torbjorns and, you know, stuff that you're directly countering with Hanzos and Widowmakers. Then two Hanzos and a Widowmaker makes sense, so you can't, like, force people out of that. because it may be the solution to your problems.
But it usually isn't.
But usually it's a terrible idea.
Especially when your team already doesn't have a tank or a healer.
Yes.
But at the same time, I guess that's kind of the fun of the game, is that it's about just really messing with the meta. I know, like, not going... There's never going to be a meta that really relies on not having a healer. Or just going, like, with, like, I don't know, whatever combination. But I guess you're right, Voodoo. You can't really limit people.
Did you just call him Voodoo?
Voodoo. Voodoo. I don't know.
That's your new
name. I can't speak. Yeah. But at the same time, what do you think the issues with... And I want to be careful how I phrase this. Do you think the issues with the people playing the game or the system that's managing them, like, at the end of the day, do you think if people just took the game a bit more seriously, and I know that's kind of an impossible situation, I don't mean it that way, I'm not saying people aren't, but do you think if people just treated the game differently, it would work, or is it that the system is inherently twisted to not work?
I think it's half and half, honestly.
Right.
I agree. I feel like the system is a huge part of the problem, but that can easily be fixed. Blizzard will fix it when they hear people talking about it, and they will implement it and keep changing it. The thing that's the problem is the player base. If people aren't willing to change, people aren't willing to, you know, actually take the game seriously, then competitive will never change.
Honestly, how I view this is the problem with playing Overwatch, like getting people to keep playing and keep playing, directly comes from the community. Because you get people like Tarley who are like, yeah, I love the game, but it's not worth playing because everyone's a jerk.
Yeah.
And then the problem, like, on Blizzard's end is simply the fact that when you win, it doesn't feel very rewarding. When you lose, it does feel like a pretty big loss, because you do normally lose a rank when you lose a game, but you don't normally gain a rank when you win a game. So if those ratios were kind of evened out and fine-tuned, I think it'd be all right. But, like, I lost 3 games right after I was placed, and I've been trying to climb back up to that 43, but even if I'm winning more than I'm losing, I'm still stuck down at, like, 40, 41.
At least I haven't played, so I can maintain my 46.
That's it. Just get match made, and then you just sit there.
Yeah,
I'm not gonna move.
I'm getting my rewards at the end of the season either way.
As long as you're a higher rank than me, it's okay, right?
Yeah, yeah.
To be honest, if I got rank 19 in Heroes, that's exactly what I would do. I just wouldn't play for the rest of the season. I'd just hug that for my mount. Yeah. On a complete twist, the last thing for me on this, I think we talk about, like, playing roles, and it just reminds me of all those trolls in WoW who would end up just telling people in, like, LFR, like, oh, you don't know how to play your class and that sort of thing. Do you think the issue is that Blizzard relies too much on people going out onto community websites to learn how to play the game and not supporting people inside the game or officially through Blizzard on how to play with different roles, classes, or characters necessarily?
I mean, yeah, there is the in-game tutorial, but they could do better. I don't know how they could do better, but I don't know. There should be more encouragement to play tanks and heroes for sure.
But it's frustrating that the in-game tutorial is Soldier 76, which is the most generic and unspecial character in the game. You know, it's like, oh, here you go, welcome to an FPS. I think if it had, like, brought you in and said, by the way, these are how different classes function, and, like, said, this is how you kind of, you know, you're a tank, so you've got to protect people, and kind of touched on Proving Ground mentality there by having you go through some scenarios.
I'm almost thinking they should reward extra XP for people playing healers and tanks.
Oh, a bit like the bonus loot.
You kind of do get that as a healer. Like, what time have you played a healer and not got a gold medal for healing?
Okay, well, more of an incentive.
Touché, yeah.
The gold medal.
I mean, yeah, I agree. I think there should be, like, a little bit of an experience boost. That would incentivize it quite a bit. But it really come, like, I think it's much more the community than it is Blizzard, because as soon as I hopped into competitive, like, I normally play Hanzo. That's my go-to character on pretty much any map, attack, defense, it doesn't matter. But as soon as I hopped into competitive, I was almost instant locking Reinhardt, Roadhog, tanks mostly. Because I'm a terrible support, but I can tank.
You are a terrible support.
I'll admit it.
I think support's probably the one.
Bad.
That's funny enough, I'm the other way around. I can do Mercy and support really well, but I can't do DPS, which is always frustrating because I'll see my team just crumble and I feel like I can't really do anything because if I swap, then we haven't got a healer and it's just, ah. So, yeah.
All right, well, we kind of rambled on about Overwatch there for a bit. And the next topic is also about Overwatch. Britzza, you posted this link. What's going on here?
Yeah. So this is it's definitely a sad story, but it's I guess it's kind of got a nice essence to it. It's a sad story, but it's got a nice ending in some ways. So Overwatch,
like Game of Thrones, basically.
Yeah, a bit like Game of Thrones. It's what's happened is that the devs at Blizzard have put in a tribute to a player who was a big fan of the game, a player from China, named Hong Yu Wu, and he was a big fan of the game. He was really excited to play, but unfortunately he was killed in a road traffic accident the day before the game came out, and it kind of picked up, the story picked up a lot of traction in the community, and Blizzard decided to recognize him by putting in, is it Lijiang Tower, there's a spacesuit with his name, Hyung Woo, and above it's the phrase, all in Chinese, heroes never die. So, you know, we kind of, in a similar vein, like how we've seen the same thing with WoW, it's nice to see, you know, Blizzard recognize things like this, and again, sort of just really instill that sense of community, and yeah. It's kind of it.
That's why I love Blizzard. I mean, they're such a awesome company because they do stuff like that.
Have you ever seen game like this on a serious note? Have you ever heard of like think of an example where another game outside of Blizzard has ever done something like this? Has League of Legends ever done anything like this? Or
I've heard of other games doing similar things, but not for like community members, for like their own personal staff.
Right.
There was a guy who got married who worked for. Oh, what company was that? I spaced it. At any rate, you can glitch the game and look behind this like mountain in it, and it's a picture of this guy and his wife that they included in the game because they got married like right as the game was finishing up.
Halo had a lot of stuff like that too. There, you could always find like different things with their own dev team. Like I always remember the monkeys on the first level of Halo 3. You would find this monkey family of one of the lead developers, and he was his face on a monkey holding a bunch of baby monkeys, all with his face. Very strange.
It's pretty nice.
Blizzard, yeah, good job, Blizzard. All right.
Yeah, moving on.
World of Warcraft shares experience. World of Warcraft player shares experience as guild leader for 8 years. So the phrasing of that, does that mean he shares the experience of that he gains while leveling up for 8 years, or he shares what it's like to be a guild leader for 8 years?
He has gathered experience for 8 years and shared it with all of us.
So and we are now all level 100.
Instantly, we are all level 150 already. I'll quickly go through this one because we've got the Q&A in a bit. But this is a post from Sean Holmes, and I'll put the link in the description. And he's one of these many sort of guild leaders who are coming out as we approach Legion. And let's be honest, the community over the last couple of years, and particularly now, is going through a transition. The game's going through a transition. And it's very, you know, at the end of the day, it's coming down to the people. Who are the people playing the game still? As much as what game are they playing? And Sean has written an incredible, I think it's like 198-page, 30,000-word testament over the years to what it's like for him to manage this guild. And the long and short bit, and I think we touched on this in a previous discussion topic, is that he feels like it's taught him a lot of skills. And a lot of it's given him a lot of experiences that a lot of people would love to have in the real world. But if anything, it's probably instilled in him a real mentality on what it means to succeed as a leader and what it means to actually, you know, suffer and deal with all the sort of the heartbreaking you know, all the negative side that comes with, you know, being with people sometimes who are separated through a keyboard and aren't always connecting as well as they should. So it really is incredible. And I won't spoil what he's saying because his words speak way better than I could summarize them. But I just wanted to quickly get you guys, your perspective on this. Like, we talked about how raiding and guild leadership perhaps teaches you things that can you could benefit life. I'm sure there's an episode, I think one of the highlight episodes was when we talked about like things you could tell your boss or something about raiding.
Yeah, that was probably one of the best episodes.
I don't know which episode that was, but if anyone in chat or on Twitter or listening can tell us which episode it was, that'd be great. But I guess, do you feel like playing Blizzard games has given you anything in particular or strengthened anything in you particularly, anything at all, that...
My finger strength. You know,
possibly the most controversial thing you could have said.
I mean, I don't know. Because I've been playing Blizzard games as long as I can remember. So I don't know. I guess I don't know what I would be like without World of Warcraft at this point, or... If it has shaped me, if it's not, I guess it's hard to tell. Maybe I'd have more relationships in my life if it weren't for World of Warcraft. I don't know.
It's hard to say. What about you, Big Voodoo? Anything in particular? Or
you know, I don't think World of Warcraft really ever shaped me.
You shaped it.
Yes. I created the World of Warcraft. No. I would say... Video games overall, yes, and even some Blizzard titles, StarCraft, for sure. Like, I think that's where a lot of my problem solving, where I learned a lot of my problem solving at an early age was in StarCraft. You know, people are doing this, how do I play against it? Or the computers are doing this, how do I play against it? Because I had dial-up back then, and it was terrible. But I wouldn't say WoW has ever really shaped me. I wouldn't say, maybe Diablo. I had a friend that I played a lot of Diablo with, so maybe a little bit Diablo. But I would just say StarCraft.
Yeah, I wouldn't say necessarily that WoW shaped me either, but it's always been like a constant. You know, as you grow up, everything changes in your life, and you go through all these different things. You always have, like for me, it's always been World of Warcraft is always the same place I can go, play the same character I've had for so many years. And I'm thankful for World of Warcraft.
Aww. Yeah, I think I'm in the same boat. I don't think it shaped me. I know there's a lot of nostalgia, and I've really have grown up with WoW and a lot of these other games. And I don't know, I think probably less, because I've never led a guild, I think that's probably why these people are writing these articles, because yeah. There's something about guild leadership and other things that you learn, and I wouldn't understand that. But I do think like it teaches lessons. I think very much like you, Big Voodoo, it's about, I feel like gaming in general has taught me, like, if people don't talk to one another, it's all going to go wrong, and that sort of thing. Yeah, I think it's probably like giving me an insight into the human condition, if I can be as bold to say that. But I think it's certainly worth a read of, you know, all 30, maybe not all 30,000 words, but certainly worth a read of Sean's piece, because I'm sure there's some lessons that everybody can learn from it, what it's like to lead or whatever.
All right, so I think that about covers all the news. We've talked about that for quite a while. It is time to jump right into this week's discussion.
Or the of the
discussion
week.
Of the week.
And then he swooped down from above I tell ya, you should have seen the size of those wangs. I swear, Borondax could hardly cut through a gnome. What's a Drenna anyhow? Can I drink it?
Discussion of the week.
That's right, it's time for the discussion of the week. And, you know, 2 years into the show, I'm going to point this out now about this sounder. You know, it says in the sounder, you should have seen the size of those wings. But with the accent he's going for, you should have seen the size of those wangs. Like, anybody else?
No, I do hear that. I do hear that. Admittedly, I thought it was just me.
And I've laughed to myself about it every single episode.
But, oh dear, anyway. We can't change it now.
We can't. But anyway, this week's discussion is all about PvP in Legion. This last Thursday, they had the Q&A with Brian Holinka. He's the PvP guy over there at Blizzard.
He's the PvP guy.
And admittedly, this one was a lot shorter than the last two. Not a whole lot to cover as far as PvP goes. But we'll dive right into it. So the first thing they talk about is class balance. And, you know, they talk about general class balance questions. We're not entirely happy with class balance on the beta yet. Balance decisions are sorting themselves out alongside artifacts. Artifact tuning isn't the highest priority because you won't have full artifact power for a while, focusing on launch. The new system, PvP multiplier for every spell, so balancing might be... these notes are kind of jumbled. This may be done for... This may have been... I can't read. This has been done for a lot of artifact traits. We are now just starting to change individual values for those PvP multipliers. So basically what that boils down to is if you think class balance is how it is right now, how it's going to be at launch, don't panic. Tanks aren't going to be able to swifty one-shot macro everybody. Because that's kind of what's happening right now. Yeah. Every tank spec just blows somebody up on the beta. I saw a video of Swifty rubbing his keyboard against his face in a duel. And he killed them.
Jeez.
Yep.
I don't want to play that class.
It was a
yeah.
Let's see. What about utility spells? Worried Legion PvP is like a PvE damage race. Incorrect. Early on in the beta, damage was way too high. Healers were undertuned. When we lower damage tuning a bit, utility spells will shine. So yeah, just everyone's doing a lot of damage right now, and they just have to bring it down. Big Voodoo, you look so
stressed.
No one's
doing any healing.
This.
Man, I have a hard time really, like, when they say PvP isn't balanced and we're looking into it, I'm thinking, has it ever really been? Like, I'm pretty sure I've heard that same answer in every Q&A that has ever mentioned PvP from WoW.
Well, we know that they'll still be talking about it, you know, patches into Legion, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Balancing. So it's, you're right, they can never master it. All they can do is look at what content they've got and how far people have developed their artifact weapons in a certain period of time and go, right, we'll just balance it for that. And then when people get so far, they'll go, oh, God, it's all a mess now.
They've also talked about, let's see, changes to mobility. How, like, there's classes that are both way too mobile and do way too much damage, and this is being looked into. And the specific example of this is the Havoc Demon Hunter. The Demon Hunter, like, say, Warsong Gulch, can be from one base to the other in less than 15 seconds. It's crazy. So a class like that should not be doing nearly as much damage as it can do. So they're nerfing its damage, because Havoc Demon Hunters could essentially three-shot people as well.
Well, I think the stab at mobility is a really harsh one, because you think about, like, the trailer for the Demon Hunters. It's like, look how mobile they are. They can jump everywhere. And then they're like, PvP, they're like, we're going to just tie you to the ground now. Yeah. It's just...
Well, yeah, they're not nerfing their mobility, really. They're just making damage.
Yeah. So. But I think people will criticize the Demon Hunter for being what it's trying to be.
Yeah.
They'll be like, God, you can get everywhere. It's like, yeah, but that's the point of a Demon Hunter. I agree with the damage nerf. That's fair enough, though.
I wish there was a different page that summarized this, because it's like literally kind of like reading question, trying to read answer instead of like a summarized view of all this, so trying to get this all here.
So we can, I think we can just go straight to loot, to be honest.
Yeah, we've heard all of this before. They want, people wanted some clarification, PvP gear being only out of loot boxes. And the answer to that was, gear is now rewarded on victory. Just purely on victory, you get gear. That's guaranteed when you win gear. And now PvP, now PvP gear has a chance, as every other gear, Legion item, gear, piece, thing, does have a chance to be upgraded in eye level. We wanted to give away, we wanted to get away from vendor systems because this is a flat experience. They don't think it's fun. They've said this like 100 different times and people disagree with them. Whatever. When things are less predictable, it's a little more exciting when you get what you want, a little more disappointing when you don't. We are aware that PvP has always been vendors, so we're putting in bad luck protection against things like repeating piece of gear. This also may allow us to create gear on par with PvE, since it's not as determined on how you get it. Overall, I just don't think the gear really matters. I mean, with stats being equalized, people should calm down. Yeah, I think it matters for everything else. I would love Valor and Honor and Justice, whatever, vendors for every other type of content, but since item level, since it's all equalized in PvP, it really doesn't make a difference. What do you guys think?
I'm probably part of the minority in the fact that I'm really happy that all of the currencies are gone.
Yeah.
I prefer getting gear from loot instead of just mindlessly grinding for days.
Okay.
It's more enjoyable. Yeah, it may reduce my chances to get the gear, but I'm not sitting there going, okay, I'm 2 days in and I'm missing X amount of points. Guess I better go do a few more raids or a few more dungeons or a few more battlegrounds, whatever it may be.
That's a fair point. I do like that it is a guaranteed piece of gear from a victory now. Mm. Like, playing the last couple days in BGs, you know, you win a game, you get a gold strong box, and there's 12 gold in that strong box. You're like, thanks.
Shouldn't it be at least like 100? Like,
you would think.
Let me
gold.
Vendor the strong box made of gold for something, you know?
Yeah. So at least you're guaranteed a win, or from, you're guaranteed a win.
Guaranteed a win. Awesome.
You're guaranteed a gear from a win, and then if not, if you lose, you can still get, you get a strong box that gets you different items that are still useful. So, and they talk more about Pat's stats. I'm just all over the place with my reading today. Someone else should be reading. They talk more about PvP stats. A baseline for 800 item level, you'll have 850 in PvP. Each eye level increase will increase your stats by 1% power. So the range from will be from 850 to 860 eye level max for PvP. So, yeah, really, you can only get a 10% increase in player power. So that, in comparison to like over 100% increase that is from a fresh level 100 now to a fully geared level 100, it's crazy. That's a huge improvement.
It gets rid of the one shot. Well, it won't necessarily get rid of the one shots, maybe, but certainly reduces just how disgustingly unbalanced the game could be if you run into someone who's fully geared.
Yes, there is the Titan Forge system in PvP for some reason. Will gearing up with PvP gear and then using it in PvP or PvE be viable in Legion? Yes. From winning, though, not such a gimme anymore. If you are good at PvP, then you will get gear, which you can use in PvE. So, if you're bad at PvP and you're just losing all the time, then it's not going to be a faster way for you to gear up than doing dungeons or world quests or what have you. But yeah, if you're good,
it could potentially be a more beneficial way to gear up, though.
It could be, but it is going to, like, the baseline. There's a chart I saw somewhere that shows you, like, baseline just, I don't remember what the non-rated versions of arenas are called, skirmishes. So skirmishes and non-rated BGs only go up to a certain amount of eye level normally, and then you can Titan Forge up, but it's very rare to get those really good pieces of gear. And then, of course, doing then rated BGs or arenas gets you starts at a higher baseline eye level by default, and then the highest quality get chances way higher. So yeah, if you do rated, you could definitely, and you're good at rated, yeah, you can definitely gear up that way.
It just, it seems like finally the PvP system is starting to match the PvE system of dungeons, heroics, raids. It's just there now seems to be a progression system clearly mapped out with effectively random loot determining progress, which I think is going to help a lot better. It's nice to see that coming together at last. That's, you've effectively got two routes of progressing, and yeah, and they're effectively tiered in terms of what you want to, like you say, you don't want to be doing skirmishes if you've got all but the maximum gear. You want to be pushing for higher content. So I think that's really good, to be honest.
Big Voodoo, you look like you have something to say.
So my biggest thing is, like, I don't really want to gear with a dungeon if I can gear in PvP and work on getting my prestige ranks to get that really cool artifact skin. Because the prestige artifact skin for Honor is, like, the coolest one on almost every single weapon.
I would agree, yeah, the PvP ones are really cool.
And then on top of it, like, there's also a really cool mount that you get for hitting, what, rank, or prestige 3, I think?
Yeah.
Yes.
So, like, I don't know. It just seems like the better option at this point.
Yeah.
Other rewards.
You just said PvP's better than PvE, you traitor. To the dungeon.
I mean, at this point, I would say it is until, you know, Mythic Dungeons come out, but yeah. I mean, there's just going to be so much to do, just off point, so much to do in Legion for someone who doesn't raid, that that alone makes me happy.
Good point.
And another thing they said about gear, with the removal of Honor, will old PvP gear cost gold? And unfortunately, no, it will not. That's boring. We think it's important that you can, that you do PvP, but those things will now cost Marks of Honor, which you get in the PvP strong boxes. Doing any instance PvP can earn you Marks of Honor, which you can use to buy old PvP gear. I don't know if it's a bug in the system or if it just something weird has happened, but when I logged onto the PTR and went to test out the transmog system, I saw that none of the PvP sets I had in the past were available in the transmog system, and I don't want to have to just earn all these Marks of Honor to go get those awesome looking Death Knight sets that I used to have.
I think the system should pick up that you've owned them.
I would think so. I hope it's not bugged.
Yeah.
I hope it is, but
I'm sure they will allow it, because it's not, like you said, that's ridiculous.
We'll allow it.
Yeah.
Well, and the PTR is an entirely separate account too.
Well, no, I mean, you can copy your account data, because it had all of my PvE gear.
Oh.
In this, like, that I had unlocked over the years, which was cool to go through and see.
It's probably where they're pulling the data from. It might be a separation between PvP in some way.
I mean, I guess. But what do you guys think about the Marks of Honor thing? I mean, why, if that's the case, shouldn't there be Marks of Justice or Marks of Valor, and you have to go do the old raids to get the gear? I mean, in a sense, in a lot of the gear, you still have to. Like, you can't buy everything from a vendor, but a lot of the sets you can.
I think it makes sense in, like, a sort of elitist perspective. You think, like, some of this gear does look really cool.
Yeah.
But if you can just pick it up, then effectively what you're doing is you're giving some really cool looking transmogs to people for almost nothing, cause the gold isn't really that much. So I think, you know, in a sense, part of the PvP, that prestige is earning the look that you've got, and I see what they're trying to get. Hopefully it's not too steep though.
Yeah.
I think what they should just do is have it,
one piece is like, I saw they're anywhere between 1 to 5 Marks of Honor, so.
Oh, there you go. So
no, that's not bad.
Yeah. Yeah, if you're just doing PvP and there you go, Nod, you can go buy some transmog gear, that's fine.
Yeah.
If it was like 500, then it's like, well, what's the point? It's outdated gear and it's no, there's no real use for it other than transmog.
As with the beginning of any new season, when the pre-patch comes out, all of your honor and all your conquests will be converted to gold. Unfortunately, it will not be converted to Marks of Honor. But I think, I may be wrong on this, but I think, well, even just from the pre-patch, you can do BGs and start earning Marks of Honor. So.
Awesome.
Big
question next.
Did you want to read?
Yeah, why not? I'd take over. So they asked, what's the incentive to do rated PvP? Which is a big question, because I've never really done rated PvP ever. In some ways, I'm quite scared of it.
Big Voodoo and Icarus tried, and we just couldn't decide on a comp. We all leveled up characters like four different times, and we're just like, nah, we can't do it.
Never mind. What they said to that was, it's different. It's a more intense activity than your standard PvP, naturally, hence why I'm terrified of it, and you guys didn't get there. They say the motivators should be gear and prestige level, and skirmish mode, random battlegrounds, and the first day bonus give you double honor. Rated brackets though will offer 50% more honor on top of that, so it's certainly a more efficient way to earn the high eye level gear. But they say the higher change for Titan Forged in rated, and it also increases with your chance. Yeah, I can't even read the last bit. It doesn't make any sense.
Right, okay, it's not just me. I think some of the sentences are poorly structured. Some of this doesn't.
I listened to it, but it just doesn't make sense reading it back.
Yeah.
I don't know how they phrased it when they were talking.
So everybody put on their tinfoil hats then once Brian Halinka said this next point. Season lengths are still tied to raid tier releases. So you can basically say he said that they wanted them to be about 10 to 15 weeks. So that's the patch cycle.
10-15 weeks.
Oh, but they're short.
Two seasons per.
So yeah, about 20 to, or 20.
30 weeks.
30 weeks.
20 to 30, 30 weeks.
20 to 30 week raid cycles.
Raid cycles.
Yeah.
With two PvP.
I would imagine the seasons will still come with like mid patches. I would assume.
30 weeks. That's. Over 7 months
between patches.
Nice.
That's 20 to 30 weeks. Come on.
Okay, worst case scenario, that's five. Best case scenario, it's 5 months.
But
which I guess is acceptable, to be honest.
I would say that I don't have any problem with this if they're doing like the patches at the 10-week point.
Like, if they're adding dungeons in with those patches and adding, like, more content overall for everyone with each patch, mm-hmm. I think it'll be okay.
Yeah. It can't be, 6.1 with the only content being a selfie camera.
And that's what jumped into my head was, like, hang on a second. 7 months is a long time to wait when you've only got a camera. But, yeah, I know that they will plan dungeons and other things in there, so...
But I guess like you said, a mega dungeon Karazhan, in 7.1.
But if anything,
what did you say about a dungeon in 7.1?
There's going to be a mega dungeon in 7.1. They've already confirmed that, and it's most likely going to be Karazhan.
I remember us. I think I remember you mentioning it. I can't. For some reason it left my head. Anyways.
Okay.
Okay.
But what I was going to say was, I think what we've been talking about has shown that we all seem pretty happy with the idea of switching between PvP and PvE, mm-hmm. which I think is going to help the content drought scenario. You know, like, you're right, 7 months isn't long, but if you're getting new PvE content and then you've got the option twice to go for a new PvP season, that could keep me entertained for quite a long while. So,
and all that while, you'll be getting higher attunements on your Mythic Dungeons, and you'll be like doing this and this. I mean, yeah, I just feel like content
getting your
relevant for a long time.
Good point.
Yeah. All right. What was the next thing? Big Voodoo, talents, you should read some.
I lost where we're at.
Talents and templates.
Ah, I was right there.
He's paying attention.
I'm vaguely paying attention. Talents activate in all PvP situations, but not templates. What do they mean by templates?
What?
They talk about talents and templates. What are templates?
Are templates like the normalized numbers for PvP?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Base numbers. Okay. Right, okay.
So, talents will activate immediately in any PvP situation. So if you're out in the world doing world PvP, they should activate there.
You have your PvP talents, yeah.
That
includes world PvP, correct? Not just duels, but you come across a opposite faction and boom, your talents are turned on.
but the templates don't.
Right. So your gear, your gear will be a huge factor in world PvP. So that I guess is upsetting some people, but Blizzard can't make everybody happy.
It's world PvP.
Yeah.
Yeah, a lot of so the, questions the, about yeah, numbers overall. Yeah,
like the next one also about, go on, Tully.
Yeah, they just want to know why they can't tune, why we can't tune stats on PvP templates. And the answer was customization comes from honor talents. So that is your customization, is the talents, not being able to adjust your stats. Although, yes, some secondary stats for some specs are problematic. Some are overly bursty, so we can't set them manually. A cleaner way of letting you specifically increase secondary stats through a complicated system of gear talents. So I read that strangely, but yeah, they are manually tuning stuff. During the interview, he specifically actually mentioned Warlock Mastery. I think it was Warlock Mastery, and how it specifically in PvP it was so broken, and they just turned off mastery for warlocks in PvP. That was their answer to it.
Which spec?
I think it was destruction.
It probably would be destruction.
Okay.
Hence why they probably spent so long trying to get them sorted for Legion.
Yeah.
So I'm really excited for Affliction in Legion, but I'm really bummed out for Affliction in PvP in Legion, because they're like their big bonus from their artifact. They don't really get, because it's all about killing stuff to get it.
What was the PvP twist on it, though? Wasn't it like it I think it automatically activates at full power when you start PvP, though.
Yeah, and that was an example of like several artifact abilities that are will be specifically tuned once you're in PvP.
Yeah, you won't have to like kill 30 players to get your artifact power. Yeah. I think it just starts powered up, and then as you do damage or something like that, you're not penalized anyway.
And Big Voodoo, you want to tell us why they're gating PvP talents?
Because they're evil.
To give everyone something to work towards is the idea with it. Mm-hmm. So the first 10 levels, is that right? Yeah, first 10 levels, you will always get one talent that goes down the row, the first row.
And that essentially, according to them, is still pretty much full player power. I mean, you have something from each tier.
And then after that, you start unlocking the rest of the talents in each tier. That way, you can customize how your power is distributed instead of, but still essentially have the same power. Yeah. Make it accessible, but still give you options.
Yeah. And the first 10 levels, they said you get that very quickly.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I keep losing my train of thought today.
I'll take the next bit. So they talked about they're talking about timelines now. So they talk about whether they can expect more frequent tuning because of how the new systems are being integrated. Mm-hmm. And they say basically they use the word granular. The answer is yes. They can generally change things quicker. And they use the word hotfix, so do things on the fly. So if things are ridiculously broken or not being helpful for the style of play, they can kind of just go in and make the changes there, and then the system's better for them to do that. And they talk about will PvP talents change per season, and they're a bit kind of, it's kind of they can, but they're not sure if they will or how they're going to do it. They say that they'll look at them regularly and replace underused or unfun talents, but not every season and not every talent will change, but they'll just keep looking at them. So they use the example. So prestige levels are going to be added every season and talents will not be reset between seasons. So you're just getting new levels more than anything else. So basically the answer is they can change things and they will look at changing things, but that doesn't mean they will change it. Which is pretty much what you'd expect.
Yeah. and of course, the question had to be asked, will we get new battlegrounds? And Brian Hulinka responded by saying, yes, it has been way too long. They agree that it's been too long, and it's not a good place to be in. They are adding two new arenas, Blackbird Cold and Ashmain's Fall, and an old favorite, Grand Arena, is getting a facelift. But we have not done a good job of getting new battlegrounds going. The conversation on how to get
done are happening. So, of course, they do. They're looking into new battlegrounds. Hopefully, we'll get one in the patch cycle of Legion, at least one. Be nice. We haven't gotten a new one since that really weird one that came out in the middle of Mists of Pandaria that I still don't know fully how that battleground works. I just kind of kill people in it.
Is that the one with the flags?
The one with the cards. Do you capture the cards?
Yeah, and you have to run around the arena. Yeah. That was awful. I remember when I had to do the legendary quest bit for that. That sucked.
Oh, yeah, you had to do... Yeah. Not even that one. I know which one you're talking about. No, that's Temple of Khatmogu.
Yes.
This is the one added like midway, and it takes place... I don't know. There's like mind cards and... Yeah, it was weird. Anyway.
Do you think that's a bad sign that if they're talking about having the conversations on getting it going, it doesn't sound like none of that was we've got an idea for one.
Yeah.
So
I don't know.
At
why.
Best, I think what third patch or
Do you think final patch? It's taken so long to get a new BG, but we need one.
After everything like they've designed, I don't see why. You know, this is typical player, you know, bragging, but I don't see why it's been difficult to get one because. Yeah. You know, surely it's like any.
I still like Tarley's idea and do like a MOBA battleground.
Right.
I think that would be pretty sweet.
That would be cool.
I think it would be awesome. Let's put our tinfoil hats on here for a bit. If they were to do a MOBA battleground, would it be just like 5v5? Would it be like it's still like a 10v10 and it's still lanes and minions? 40v40.
40.
Or
maybe 40v40 and you are the minions.
And you have big heroes coming down the lanes and fighting each other.
You have titans turn up and fight it out. That'd be really cool.
That would be
I don't know. I think it would have to be like at most 10v10.
Yeah. I mean, if they kept it true to a MOBA that there are minions going down the lanes, there's towers to break. Ultimately a nexus to kill. I don't know. I don't know if it would work or not.
Ashran's not that far off in a sense. You know, if you think about that, it's PvP, but you kind of go off and do jungling in some respects and whatnot.
Yeah.
It's not that far out. They just need to formally put it in a MOBA style setting.
Yeah.
Where you have to go off and sort of kill mobs and take down towers. Mobs, that would be really crazy. But then again, I guess the problem is people will say, well, you're just copying Smite.
But it's WoW. I mean, come on.
Yeah, but it's WoW.
And Smite was a good game, so
Smite is a good game.
With the action camera, the way it looks, and then, a MOBA, it would look just like Smite, too.
Maybe it's time for Blizzard to start stealing other people's ideas.
They do it already. That's what Blizzard is known for.
What do you mean?
They don't steal other people's ideas. They just
acquire them without permission.
They appropriate it and then make it better and rebrand it as their own.
Blizzard is the Apple of gaming. They don't necessarily invent things, but they just make it and then make it so everybody likes it.
Yeah, that's probably pretty accurate.
That's the name of this episode, aside from anniversary episode. Blizzard, Apple of gaming.
Apple of gaming. Just to hit the last two questions quickly. Right. So they talk about, are they going to make a new Wintergrass curable like Ashran? Mm-hmm. And they say they see the value in nostalgia, but they were meant for their time. So things are being discussed for the future, but it's possible that future events in those older style world zones might come back, but nothing on the cards. Yeah, I don't see a reason why you couldn't bring that back. Like, in a sense, like how they do time walking. Why can't you just time walk to an old PvP zone? Mm-hmm. And they say any updates to older battlegrounds. It's hard to change old favorites, but possibly visual updates. I'm very glad to see that, because if you think about Ulterick Valley and how pixely that thing looks, that needs an update.
Looking Ulterick Valley with the old mechanics of Ulterick Valley. Make it take like 3 hours to win one game.
Oh god. Please no.
Nobody queues into AV anyway.
When you can queue into AV and then go do solo questing while you're in there.
Oh my god,
the game still isn't over.
Yeah.
That was the that maybe was the first ever MOBA.
in a sense, yeah. Let's see. We can probably quickly go through the rest of these topics here. Cheating in rated PvP. Will it be more Bandwave's punishment? And they're discussing it happening on how to communicate what Blizzard is doing to combat cheating. They can't really talk about it because then the cheaters would be on to them, so they don't actually tell them what they're doing to combat it too often. But they're also looking into the ways that aren't just punishing users, trying to actually prevent cheating in the first place. Because, you know, cheaters are like half of their player base at this point, so they can't kick them all out.
Why don't they do a Twitch chat? They do an arranged Twitch chat, and they say, for anyone who wants to know how to get past our cheating system, come to Twitch, and they just ban everyone who turns up.
There you go.
Other companies have tried it. Please don't do it.
Professions. People are like, why are you removing our engineering toys? I want my goblin glider. And it was an oversight. They didn't mean to do it. They'll probably bring him back.
Back. Sorry.
Accessibility to new PvPers. Templates normalizing gear levels for sure. That's obviously a really good incentive for new players to hop in. Also, honor levels are a good gauge for experience. And that means you will be placed in a separate bucket for queuing. Matchmaking systems do help with equal competitors, but makes for longer queue times. But this is a minor alteration. So they're queuing you based on what your honor level is? Is that what I'm getting out of that?
I was trying to apply the word bucket. It's the first time I've ever had the word bucket used.
Essentially, if you're ranked 10 prestige 1, you'll get placed with other people who are approximately that same rank.
That's going to take forever, Q.
Well, maybe not.
As long as you're at a normal pace, you should be fine. Although, after you hit, like, say you're leveling an alt and the game's been out for a while, and you try and start PvPing with him, I could see it taking a long time. Because then you're rank 1 prestige 0, and everyone who actually PvPs is, you know, max rank at that point.
But what if you're a person who doesn't even want a prestige at all? You just sit at level 50.
Then you're dumb, and no one loves you anyways.
Fair enough. If that's what you wanted to do, you heard it from Big Voodoo first, you're dumb. Let's see, World PvP. You had a point?
No, I was going to say, I think Voodoo has a point that they're not intending for people just to sit at 50. So,
there's too many rewards to gain from prestige. So why would
exactly.
You World PvP. In Legion, there will be a free-for-all World PvP in 4 areas. Huh?
Somewhat related to the world quest. Fight as a Murloc.
Tame and mount and fight on beasts. Fight on beasts.
Beasts.
Oh, what? I don't think I listened to this part or saw this part earlier until like just now. Will PvEers have an edge? No. Trust us, they say. So, that's awesome.
I want to play as a Murloc.
I want to fight from a beast.
I think in the Murloc match, the only people who have the edge are the people who have the fishing artifact weapon. Just beating a Murloc to death with a fishing rod. That's the future of PvP, people. That's awesome. And it's great as well, like, the fight on beast system. Like, I'm surprised that hasn't got used from the Grand.
I don't know why I haven't anywhere seen else. Like anything, any videos of this from the beta. Like, I just literally have not heard of this at all. I wonder if
it can't be in there yet. Like, I can't. I haven't seen anything on it.
Anywho, any replacement to the Arena Master title achievement? Yes, but we aren't sure what yet we should replace it with. And then they go on to talk about prestige rewards. Reward at honor level 50 changes with every prestige rank. First rank is a groupie. It's a little pet. You either get the Alliance Enthusiast or the Horde Fanatic. Second prestige rank is an artifact appearance. Third is a courser mount. You can pick one of these, I guess. I would assume there's like,
I think so.
1, 2, 3, 4, 6 of them.
Mm.
I guess they're just different colored versions of the same thing. And then fourth is an honorable pennant.
Okay. It seems like the fourth, I'm trying to figure out, represent your faction. It doesn't sound as cool as like a mound.
Yeah.
It's me.
I'm not sure what the pennant is for, really.
I think it's a banner.
I feel like the mount should come before the... I don't know. Maybe that's just me. Like the mount.
Yeah,
I think four, you get the banner as well as the title.
Yeah, the prestigious. Yeah.
Oh, right. I'm with you.
And, of course, there will be more ranks added through patches, so you don't just get four and cap out. There will be more and more added to the game. Are there incentives to play non-rated? And they responded with, we do like people doing rated, and we do want people to do it, but it's totally fine. Who just want to play non-rated. The whole new system that we've built benefits them most in terms of rewards from non-rated play. That was such a generic answer.
Yeah. That sounds like a no.
Yeah. Well, non-rated is rewarding in the fact that it gives you rewards for non-rated play. TLDR. Like, okay. And then, of course, cross-faction partying. The divide of Horde and Alliance is very important to WoW PvP.
What?
Go figure.
Yeah, I figured that would never happen. I don't know why that's even a question. But yeah, that about sums up the Q&A. PvP seems very interesting.
I want that mount.
Yeah?
It's pretty sweet.
I gotta get it before Big Voodoo.
You probably will.
I want Murloc fights.
Right, yeah, that just sounds awesome. No, I mean, I don't know how balanced it's going to be. I mean, personally, like, Mists of Pandaria I thought was really balanced. That was, like, the time when I was doing rated arenas and thought it was fun.
BC.
But, I mean, in comparison to Warlords, PvP seems fantastic. So I guess we'll just have to see how it shapes up, how balanced it ends up being.
But yeah, I think everyone should just... Go on, sorry.
I was just going to say, I think the equality of stats is a very good thing. I mean, it's a PvP system. It should be.
And I think as well, that the thing we should all be relieved at, and the thing I imagine Blizzard is probably being relieved at, is that the new system means they can make these changes quickly. So, if it doesn't work, don't worry. They'll fix it straight away. And they'll figure out, you know, how to make the game fun and balanced and everything. And it seems like that kind of nullifies the whole, well, my class sucks. Well, okay, we'll boost it up and we'll fix things more quickly. And that's I'm really glad they've got that, because it was a bit of a nightmare with Ashran, to be honest.
Definitely. Any closing remarks, Big Voodoo on PvP? What do you think? Thoughts?
I hope that it's well enough balanced that I can get into it again, because I really enjoyed PvP back in Vanilla and Burning Crusade. So hopefully it gets to the point where it's actually decent to play again, and I can get back into it and start playing my Affliction lock again. Even though Demo looks really cool.
What is your other spec? Is Demo, or is it?
So I have Destruction right now because, well... Destruction's just kind of the generic go-to for Warlocks if you're doing anything PvE related. But I've always been a sucker for Affliction. That's what I leveled my Warlock as all the way back in Classic. And now we get Siphon Life back. And I love and miss Siphon Life. So.
Awesome.
Cool. All right. Well, that wraps up the discussion of the week. And now, of course, the part you've all been waiting for. Heroes Call! That's right. We're doing a special shout out to the listeners, of course, for being here for 2 years of Geeks of Azeroth. And by doing that, we're giving away not one, not two, not five, not four, but three.
Who? You brought it back.
Three copies of Legion. And we want to tell you how. Britzza, why don't you tell them how they can win a copy of Legion.
Mm-hmm. Yes. yeah, again, I'm really relieved you kind of brought it back from 5 because I was like, hang on. it was going to be like Oprah for a minute, wasn't it?
You get a Legion! And you get a Legion! Everyone gets a Legion!
Hey, if they did that at BlizzCon, that'd be amazing. But be a bit late then anyways. Yeah. But yeah, we were talking before the show actually still about what we wanted to do to sort of celebrate the show. And we've decided that what we want to do is sort of give people a chance to shape the show as well. And just to get into it, what we want to do is have a competition for you guys to design the new avatars for the show. So the sort of portraits we have, you've probably seen them like other Geeks of Azeroth logos and things like that. I'll post them some point on Twitter. They're getting old now, and also Big Voodoo doesn't have one and he needs one. So what we want to do is very simply ask any of you to submit your drawings or artistic designs for what new avatars should look like. You can do them for one of us or all three of us.
Each individually be picking our favorites and donating a copy of Legion to you if you manage to design all three of them, and we all simultaneously decide on all three of them. You get what do they get?
They get the collector's edition.
They get the collector's edition. So if you're a super artist and we just fall in love with all three of your designs, yeah,
then you get the super version. But that's not a given. You know, it will come down to what we personally want to be our avatars for the next 2 years, 5 years, whatever of this. And yeah, so if we pick yours, you know, if Tarley and Big Voodoo choose like theirs from a group of three and I choose someone else's, then I don't know, we'll figure out how that person gets to gets one. We'll figure it out. But but we'll choose the winners that
you
way.
Get
so.
Legion and a Hearthstone pack.
So. That's it. But just design whatever you want, as long as it's got something that you think captures what we're all about individually or as a show, and just submit them, tweet them to us, email them to us, Geeks of Azeroth. I would suggest tweet them to us because the mailbox to Geeks of Azeroth gets piled with so much other junk mail. It's difficult to see what's coming in half the time. But yeah, tweet them to us. And I don't know how long we want to do this for. When do we want to close it? Should we say
next week?
2 weeks or next week?
Yeah.
Next week? Oh, let's say 2 weeks because it might take time for people
Okay, 2 weeks. 2 weeks.
2 weeks from now.
2 weeks. Yes.
We're pros at this winging it thing still.
Yeah. That's 2 years.
And if you don't have any artistic ability, then just find some memes and use those. And if they're good enough, they will be all right.
We will accept stick men.
Yes.
Stick men are equally viable.
If they're good stick men.
Exactly.
But yeah, we definitely want some icons. Big Voodoo just doesn't have one and he needs one.
And we thought we'd ask you guys to help out because we're all rubbish at art and we have Legion copies. So let's train.
All right. And so that wraps it up. Thank you, everyone, so much for listening for the last 2 years of Geeks of Azeroth. As always, you can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, and Twitch. Remember that other one that we had on here that we kept saying we were going to be on and then we just were never on?
What was that?
Hitbox or something?
Hitbox, yeah. Yeah, that didn't happen.
We were never on there. You can check us out on Twitter at Geeks of Azeroth, and that's where we'll have you send your submissions, of course, to the Legion contest. You can find me personally at Tarley_Paws. Britzza, where can you find you?
You can find me at Britzza_EG.
Big Voodoo.
At B1GV00D00.
Let's speak Big Voodoo. All right,
you sound so disappointed every time.
And you can always contact the show, as he said before, geeksofazeroth@gmail.com with your fan mail, your hate mail, your love letters, your marriage requests. Send it all there, and you can send your contest submissions there as well.
Remember, do send it. I'll keep an eye on it. So don't be afraid to send them by email if you want.
Always check out epicgeeks.co.uk and check out the Epic Geeks podcast. It's on there. E3 review. Britzza was on it. Good stuff. All right. And stay tuned. Same place, same time next week for more Geeks of Azeroth, for more years of Geeks of Azeroth. And stay tuned. We might be playing a game here in a little bit.
Yar.